Hello and welcome to our special show on Budget 2020. The Finance Minister has presented the budget, but what are the implications for the investor? Today, we will talk about this. We have with us A. Balasubramanian, who is CEO of Aditya Birla Mutual Fund. Bala, thank you so much for joining us. First, what's your overall assessment of the budget? What do you think? Is the budget good or is it a non-event or it's a disappointing budget?
Hey, given the constraint in which I think the Finance Minister has presented the budget, Mr. Saab says the budget is not a bad budget, since it is relatively a budget which addresses some of the concerns which everybody has been expressing around the economy. And that's why I would probably say the budget is on a 1 to 10 scale, I would say close to about 8.
Okay. So why have the markets reacted in this way? Is it a hangover of the global markets? Kya hai wajah? Kya thoda disappointment bhi hai?
See, market ka hamesha kuch expectation rehta hai, expectation nahi aate hain, market actually gir jate hain. I think today is one because of that. And second is FAs are absent. Aaj ke din mein toh, I think only India is working because of the budget. Otherwise, global investors are not participating in the market. Therefore, we could probably see the lesser volume, so that expectations nahi aaye in the form of long-term capital gain tax not being cut, and so on and so forth. Those guys, I think we have seen some bit of market reacting. It normally happens every post-budget, you keep some expectations high, then you see what you see actually may not be actually meeting your expectation, therefore the market reacts. I think I would assume market will come back with a budget addresses the real pain points surrounding around rural, the economy, around agriculture sectors, around the infrastructure development needs that Government of India has to focus, such as water resource management, etc. I think all of them, I think my view would boost the sentiment. And lastly, of course, the dividend distribution tax ka jo loka expectation nahi tha, but long term capital tax ka expectation tha. But dividend distribution tax cut itself is actually increasing the money in the hands of the people, but of course they have to pay their tax at their level. But improves a lot of companies who are high dividend distribution, how dividend paying companies, but earlier they were being dividend distribution tax. But nobody understood kitna tak impact ho sakta company in terms of benefit, and therefore those companies have to be bought on the basis of this provision.
You know, one of the most sought after or one of the most looked at impact of the budget is on the income tax reforms.
Correct.
Now, the finance minister has actually announced some structural changes to the personal income tax slabs. There's been an option which has been given whether you take exemptions or you know, you take a higher tax rate. So what do you think? Will it give you more money in your hands to invest in the markets, or it will actually take away the long-term wealth creation benefits?
So I think what is the need of the youngster, the people whom they are addressing are the people who have income less than say 5 lakh rupees. Now they are making it literally no tax actually, up to 2.5 lakh rupees no tax, between 2.5% tax. Then above 5 lakh rupees they bring down the rates by almost about to 10%, then 15%, then 20%. Who are those set of people? They are all the youngsters, the middle class income people. They are youngsters. I would assume the large proportion of that people would be in that bracket, the age group between say 25 to 35. For them, the need will always be more to spend rather than creating wealth for the long term. I think at the time of joining the employment, there is no point in planning for my retirement. First few years, I have to spend money. I think definitely the budget addresses and gives the option to those people.
Okay.
You choose actually what you want to choose. Whether you want to choose savings or you want to choose get some kind of extra income in the form of tax reduction. Therefore, that money can be spent by either for spending for buying household items or for making your EMI payment towards your house purchase. I would assume people will choose the second options.
Okay.
Given a choice, given the fact that there is of filing tax returns, just simply cutting the tax by about say 15% or 10% or 20% and pay the tax and file the tax returns and save the tax, I think would probably the more ideal thing that most of the people choose. Having said that, maybe the most of the people anyway in the age group of 35 and above, who are actually above the income tax bracket of 20%, they also of course choose the section 80C provision. They will continue to do so. So I would assume this provision is the my ways of, I think, more giving option to the taxpayers, which option to choose, in my ways, master stroke. And second is giving more money in the hands of people also would boost the spending and consumptions.
You know, in terms of the discipline that actually it had brought, we also have been running a campaign, Win with SIP. So, don't you think that it's kind of taking away people from that discipline?
No, I think the money coming in the more in the hands of people, then he can choose how much you want to spend, how much you want to choose the SIP. Mm-hmm. That option is still there with him.
Okay.
Therefore, the option being given to the taxpayers, in my view, is actually the best thing that one can do. Of course, the market do react differently. Today, I saw the insurance stocks getting punished as a result of this action. Mm-hmm. But I think that my view is temporary. At the end of the day, what money comes into this segment is only so much which does not have the power to actually bring down the growth for the industry.
Okay. Also, in terms of the capital gain tax, there were expectations, like you said. But how much of a dampener is that?
It's not a dampener. See, I think the way one has to look at it, we of course keep saying it in most of the public forum when you make a representation, mm-hmm. that since the time the LTC has been introduced, the government of India has not been getting any kind of tax collection out of this provision.
Okay.
So the fundamental question to ask is when it has not been contributing to the exchequer in the form of higher tax collection,
okay.
whether at all it makes sense actually have this segment.
Mm-hmm.
And second is that the India needs a lot of growth capital. Growth capital means equity capital.
Mm-hmm.
There are many companies have to raise equity capital. Mm-hmm. They have to raise equity capital, they need to have a vibrant equity capital market. Therefore, whether it makes sense actually keep the LTCG tax at 10%. That is a fundamental question in which I think everybody is doing. Of course, government is now having to address that in the budget. I'm sure unka actually sochna hi alag rahenge isme.
Aur ye jo dividend distribution tax ki baat hai ki from corporate level, it's now made applicable to the receiver. Particularly those people who are actually maybe senior citizens or have a marginal lower rate of tax, unke liye aap kafi fayda dekhte hain, and that money can probably get channelized into investments?
Yeah, definitely, yes. I think the dividend distribution tax is a big benefit that comes actually for the people, the minority shareholders, I would say. The minority shareholders will get the significant benefit where their tax rate itself is low,
hmm.
and the dividend distribution tax is not being, tax is getting cut, there are more money in the hands of them. The recipient, therefore, that money can be invested back into the either for spending
mm-hmm.
or for investment. As you rightly asked the question about SIP, right. probably that such of investors can look at actually building the long term wealth in the form of increasing their SIP, which we call it as a step up SIP.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, talking about certain sectors, rural has always been in focus. Now, this government has again stepped up its effort on the rural sector and also on the healthcare. Slew of reforms and many new initiatives have been announced. What do you think? Will rural funds now start to gain, or it's already actually on the peak?
See, rural focused rural focused theme, the natural of course has to get the benefit for one simple reason that one is agriculture sector focus that has come,
mm-hmm.
and that can actually lead to a creation of employment, and can also lead to a higher income in the hands of people in the rural economy and the people who live in the rural economy or who are heavily dependent on agriculture sectors.
Mm.
And that in turn can actually boost the demand for consumption driven companies across the country.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, it's going to actually help that not only just economy to grow, it's also going to actually help company to increase their focus on rural consumptions.
Okay.
I think it's going to be a win-win situation both for the economy as well as for the consumer-driven companies at large.
Okay, the other side of it is probably investments from the rural sector into the capital markets, or actually in indirect ways into mutual funds, etc. Do you see the penetration now increasing? What are you doing as a fund house to go that way?
See, as a fund house for the last 5-6 years, have been going more deeper.
Okay.
The one of the areas that IEEE mutual fund have been focusing is to increase the penetration.
Mm-hmm.
The penetration is coming from the fact that the money doesn't reside only in the cities, only
right.
in Mumbai or Bangalore. I think as you go deeper parts of the country,
mm-hmm.
there is the money which is available. I think where they need actually is one proximity to their investment destinations,
mm-hmm.
proximity to the location which they live, and better service and better actually ability to create an awareness about investing in the capital market through the mutual funds, and that we felt the need almost about 6-7 years back.
Mm-hmm.
Then today we operate out of 310 locations,
okay.
and almost about 48,000 crores of our assets under management is coming from the B15 market, B30 market,
okay.
which reflects that the growth that the plan that we have is to actually make more and more investors not just invest only in from Mumbai or maybe metro cities, to but even from the far flung location of the country.
Mm-hmm. Real estate also has got some kind of benefits here. Some of the exemptions have been made possible for one more year. particularly affordable housing seems to be in focus. So is real estate finally going to come out of its problems and attract investments?
So I think real estate, we have to divide it in two parts. What the government has been focusing on affordable housing. Affordable right. housing means say less than 2 crores kind of rupees value, or maybe the income of a couple say goes up to say 30 lakh rupees, they'll get the benefit of buying a house at with some kind of exemptions being availed out of that. Mm-hmm. But the real estate problem is not in that segment. I think the current real estate problem, the thing what we generally talk about either in the newspaper or in general in the most of the discussion and debate is not about the affordable housing part. It's about, it's more about the high-end part, like place like Mumbai, the one house would cost you minimum about say 3 crores or 4 crores. That segment is still unaddressed.
Okay.
But that I think probably I would assume the developers have to find their own way of addressing the issues, either by dropping the price mm-hmm. or giving an elongated credit lines so that the consumers can come and buy.
Mm-hmm. Now talking about the banking and financial sector, there the insurance has actually been increased from 1 lakh to 5 lakhs for
correct.
The small depositors, that this is the kind of assurance now you have from the government. How will that impact the sector? Will that bring some kind of trouble because now they'll have to pay more insurance costs?
I don't think so. I don't think it will increase the insurance cost from the depositors' point of view. I think mm-hmm. the depositors' confidence for a brief period, mm-hmm. especially at the time that the cooperative banks got in trouble, mm-hmm. the confidence got shaken up from the depositors, which should not have happened. As any case in the country, the banking sector never failed to repay the depositors' money. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, this insurance which was set up maybe 20 years back, the 2 lakh rupees insurance, up to 2 lakh rupees, the money is safe. Now that is now increased to 5 lakh rupees. Definitely, I think it will boost the confidence of the small-time depositors across various banks. I think it will boost their confidence.
Mm-hmm.
From insurance cost point of view, the insurance cost actually is borne by the government or the bankers. I don't think it will actually come at a significant cost.
Okay. Now on the healthcare, again, a lot of initiatives have been taken. A lot of initiatives that had been taken, they have been extended or their scope has been expanded. How do you see the healthcare sector?
I think the budget is, as I mentioned about rural economy, I think the big boost has been given for the healthcare sector around the wellness,
mm-hmm.
which in my view, it's actually a pretty big move where the name of caring, the caring for the people, wellness of the people, and the way I think they did about a few years back about Ayushman Bharat, every individuals have to have the insurance cover up to 1.5 lakh rupees towards the health insurance sectors. Now I think they also addressed about health sectors where more and more the hospitals would also get enrolled for providing or making them eligible for availing the Ayushman Bharat kind of facilities. This is something in my view is pretty good from the health insurance sector's point of view. It will not only actually increase the awareness about focusing on your wellness or your health, it will also create more awareness about having a health insurance policy mm-hmm. along the side of your life insurance policy, which normally every individual take it. I think that in my view will create the habit of looking at the health insurance as one of the sectors. Therefore, I would assume with health insurance as a sector,
mm-hmm.
as a result of this move by the government on focusing on health as a sector, would actually create more awareness, and therefore it can also help the business to grow.
Okay. End of the day, you know, for you and for me, and for people who are actually into the investment industry, what matters is the confidence that the budget or the government policies will bring about. Now, does this address the concerns of first the institutional investors and then the individual investors?
So, I think the way I think they look at it, the government has been focusing more on individual investors in the mass at large. And second, when it comes to the kind of institutional, what is the regulatory framework they have to operate? I think if you divide the whole system into two parts, institutional segment is well governed.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, the regulatory environment has to be solid. The rules and regulatory frame in order to ensure that the systemic risk that otherwise can come and actually create havoc in the systems,
mm-hmm.
that has been addressed through the institutional framework.
Okay.
I think institutional actually is working on certain kind of framework under the regulatory framework.
Mm-hmm.
As far as the individual investors concerns, they need to have, of course, the confidence of putting their hard-earned money into the market. Therefore, they need to have the first institutional good framework in order to actually boost their confidence.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, from an individual investor's point of view, or maybe the mass and public point of view, I think they need to also be addressed, or maybe they need to be given more money for them to spend. Then comes to the question of investing. They're also now being addressed in the form of a tax cut.
Okay, and that is also probably topped by the fact that the economy has to grow. Macroeconomics have to be good. Now, do you think the reforms or the structural changes that are now announced, they will lead to a good condition of the markets, because we probably are already at highs. So, can we go higher from here?
See, the market, it will depend upon how the earnings of the company will come. I think, I don't think we should directly correlate to the budget, to the market, and then we look for Sensex at a higher number, higher level. I think Sensex will keep moving up and down. Mm-hmm. But Sensex, what will always look at, the kind of policy that is being rolled out through the budgetary provisions, mm-hmm. how they are going to actually take the Indian economy to the next levels. Today, we are talking about 10% nominal GDP growth, which mm-hmm. With the assumption that 5.5% of the GDP growth, plus 4.5% is the inflation, mm-hmm. therefore 5-10% nominal GDP growth. If the growth is about 10% nominal GDP growth, normally the companies generate about 14% earnings growth.
Okay.
At the rate of 14% earnings growth, if you look at draw a line for say next 10 years, then naturally that the market has to be upward,
mm-hmm.
and therefore the market can actually reach new highs as maybe over a period of if you take a little longer term views. Second is the market is also driven by the kind of policy framework that is being driven by the government, how far is going to take the Indian economy next levels, which mm-hmm. is about 5 trillion economy. If that confidence comes back, the money flow will come ahead of the actual results comes in.
Okay.
So, foreign investors do look at the policies, don't look at the earnings, they don't look at the GDP growth alone.
Mm-hmm.
They look at what is the future direction. The future direction is bright,
mm-hmm.
then naturally the market remain buoyant. I think we'll have to look at it from that angle.
So, you know, in terms of the discipline, I think fiscal deficit being pegged at 3.5%, is that a good indicator?
Yeah, I think this time, I think budget has the gone away from that stated policy of 3.3% GDP, that the fiscal number they will keep.
Hmm.
They have anyway taken to about 3.8, exceeding by about 50 basis points,
hmm.
which is the need of the hour. And today, you have to take a call that should allow your fiscal to slip.
Mm-hmm.
And spend more money to boost the economic growth and bring it back to about what it deserves to be in the range of about 7-7.5%, or be conservative and keep the fiscal at say 3.3 and don't spend money, and let us see, I think, whatever happens to the economy as we move along. I think having taken the path of growth,
mm-hmm.
definitely 3.3 or 3.8, I think what they have now done is something which my view should not make people worry. So even historically, if you look at India as a nation, I think finance minister put one number, I don't know how would you have noticed that.
Hmm.
48% of the GDP is only to the extent the Indian government has borrowed.
Mm-hmm.
Globally, if you have to draw a parallel of this to the Japan, it's about 250% of their GDP is their borrowing.
Mm-hmm.
In the case of US, is almost about 80 or 88% of their borrowing is equal to the GDP number.
Okay.
Whereas India is actually extremely conservative when it comes to the question of borrowing.
Hmm.
Maybe the time has come to get the number 40 goes to about 54 or 55 and let the fiscal slip and more investment happens, and therefore that boosts the economy to the next level.
Okay. To sum it up, you said 8 out of 10. But what are those two things which you could have probably wanted to see?
So, one of course is about, as I mentioned, about long-term capital gain tax.
Okay.
Definitely, when you're on collecting tax, it's better to cut it, not going to do any harm to anybody.
Okay.
And therefore, that give a clear path in terms of direction. And second is, there's one sector which has a huge capability to drive the economic growth to the next level.
Hmm.
And not just only that as alone as the sectors, even the entire ecosystem can benefit, is the real estate sectors.
Okay.
And not much focus has come on the real estate sectors, which has been struggling for quite some time, which I would assume they could have probably addressed this in the budget. Therefore, I'm saying that maybe the two takes away that.
Okay. So, finally, would you say that investors should keep investing and win with SIP?
Yeah, naturally, of course, yes. I think SIP way of investing has now become the way of investing for many.
Hmm.
And even the people who, of course, not able to predict, even the HNIs who have been long-term investors buying into stocks or making a lump sum investment, they themselves now start realizing predicting market is going to be tough.
Mm-hmm.
I think a lot of variables would actually impact the market sentiment. I think what remains constant is actually the upward trajectory of the market over a period of 5-10 years. The best way to create wealth actually is to win with the SIP, as we as a Balasubramanian mutual fund keep harping all the time, is the SIP way of investing as the best way of investing in mutual funds.
Okay, thank you so much for joining us for Budget Decoding. And this was our special show on decoding the budget and telling you what are the various announcements and what do they mean. So overall, the crux is that you should keep investing. The economy looks good in the long run. The structural measures that have been announced, they will bring about growth in the system and confidence will be boosted. Therefore, it seems that we are on the right path, and therefore you should also keep investing with discipline and also win with SIP, as we say at Birla Mutual Fund. And for this show, we'll wind up now, but if you have any suggestions, if you have any questions, you can definitely write in our comment section. Thank you so much for watching.